let's move into the current landscape of treatments, and not quite yet what's being studied and what's new and exciting, but, you know, so as I understand it, you know, there's a limited number of treatments available. If you could talk about when they're used and for how long. You were mentioning this is chronic usually, right? So are people taking the treatments indefinitely?
Yeah, it's a chronic disease. So usually when we employ treatments, they are typically, like I always say to patients, you know, patients will say, well, how long will I be on this therapy? And I say indefinitely until, you know, it may stop working or, you know, something better comes out or we change our treatment goals. So for example, you know, if you have a high risk essential thrombocythemia or polycythemia vera, and the treating physician wants to reduce your risk of having clots and control your disease better, we often put patients on a drug, for example, like hydroxyurea, which is an oral chemotherapeutic drug, which reduces blood counts. And in doing so also reduces the size of the spleen, sometimes the symptom burden and the risk of having clots. And that is done with the intent of treating the patient sort of indefinitely. It's not a 3-month or 6-month basis. So patients are often put on treatments with the idea that that might be for the, you know, potentially for the rest of their lives. And sometimes just, you know, absorbing that can be difficult because people realize when they're told that's, you know, it's a significant, you know, it's a significant change in their life if, you know, they're put on a medication, particularly a chemotherapy and all the connotations that, you know, arise with a chemotherapy, and that there's no discontinuation date. It's indefinite.
And with the hydroxyurea, what is the general site, you know, regimen and the usual side effects? Again, I know this is high level, broad strokes.
So hydroxyurea it's a capsule, very well tolerated, although there are about 15% of patients who can have toxicities from it. It's typically once a day or twice a day, usually started somewhere between 500 to 1,000 milligrams. And sometimes patients can have issues with mouth sores called mucositis, sometimes rashes or fevers, GI upset. Thankfully, they're not that common, but can happen. Sometimes people's blood counts can be quite sensitive and they can drop, so that blood counts have to be monitored. Very infrequently, less than 1% of the time, people on hydroxyurea can develop an ulceration of their skin on their ankle. It's a very specific finding, and that's a clear indication to stop the drug immediately. And then there is a theoretical risk, and I say theoretical because it's been in the literature and in patient discussions and physician meetings for quite some time, that's not actually validated by prospective data, but is a concern, and that is of the leukemogenic potential of hydroxyurea, meaning the potential for hydroxyurea to accelerate the disease as a chemotherapy, to accelerate the disease and perhaps lead to the transformation to an acute leukemia. Now, we know that hydroxyurea as a chemotherapy, particularly in Caucasians with sun exposure, can exacerbate or increase the risk of skin cancers like squamous cell and basal cell. But the you know, the data doesn't really support the idea that it promotes leukemia. And I think that really arises from historic studies, which were confounding the fact that patients often in these follow-up studies that needed hydroxyurea were usually the patients that had a very proliferative disease that were more likely to develop as a natural consequence leukemia. So when some studies look back, it was a little bit confusing or misleading to characterize those cases as hydroxyurea related. Now, many studies now have not proven that to be true. So I think hydroxyurea is a safe drug to use, but I can appreciate where there's obviously on a patient's, and I'm a patient myself, and I would also have anxiety if someone was telling me I'm putting you on a chemotherapy indefinitely. So I can appreciate that. I can appreciate that concern, but you know, I like to reassure patients and the patient community that that's not actually backed by scientific data. And with the other therapies we have, there's always, you know, the potential for toxicities, whether it's anagrelide to reduce platelets and cardiac toxicities like palpitation or GI toxicities like nausea, headaches, interferon, which is a biologic, which is an old drug that's come back and just recently got an approval for polycythemia vera. A drug called ropeginterferon or Besremi is a very important drug in this field these days. And that's a drug that also can have potential toxicities, including neuropsychiatric toxicities. So exacerbation of anxiety, mood lability, depression, you know, the difficulty concentrating. So that, you know, it's each drug has its own potential toxicity profile. And I really always caution patients to make sure that they understand in conjunction with their physician, what are the balancing acts between benefits? What is the potential benefit in which the therapy is intended to produce versus what are the potential toxicities? And, you know, when you read package inserts and you look at all the toxicities associated with the drug, you always have to remember those are potential toxicities. Those are not guaranteed. And most patients don't get those toxicities, thankfully, but you need to be monitored and you need to be vocal with your physician. If you're noticing what are called treatment emergent adverse events, toxicities that are coming on that you didn't have before, you want to make sure that you can convey that in a time efficient way to your treating physician.
And speaking of monitoring, you know, you'd mentioned hydroxyurea oral, which is great. You know, you don't have to go, you can so presumably take it at home every day. And I'm just curious how often people are having to go in to be monitored or to get their blood drawn. And also, you mentioned some other drugs or treatments. Are those infusions? Are they oral as well?
So in this field, most of the treatments are oral. So hydroxyurea is oral, anagrelide is oral. Now, interferon is a subcutaneous injection that's given either once weekly or twice weekly. The follow-up for each patient is really individualized. It depends on the subtype of disease. It depends on how frequently they need to be monitored for their blood counts will often dictate how frequently they need to come in. And for some patients, so for example, for low-risk ET patients, particularly those that harbor a mutation called calreticulin, that could be, you know, twice a year they may come in. But for some patients, for example, patients with advanced myelofibrosis that have transfusional requirements and are getting therapies that may be IV, they could be in every, you know, week or two. So it can be quite varied depending on the subtype and the risk of that patient. But the therapies do range from oral to subcutaneous, sometimes intravenous medications. One of the more common medication types that we give in myelofibrosis are JAK inhibitors like ruxolitinib and fedratinib, and those are oral drugs that are also, I would have to say, pretty well tolerated. And actually, if anything, the JAK inhibitors are typically associated with improvements, usually rapid and quite deep improvements in symptomatology.
Wonderful. So now as we shift into talking about these big highlights and clinical trials, what are you most excited by in terms of the updates really focused on the advanced myelofibrosis patient population? I know there are a lot of underserved, you know, subsets that are now being looked at, which is wonderful news. But before we dive into each one sort of high level, what areas are seeing the most sort of exciting development?
You know, probably typically myelofibrosis gets the most attention. And it's not surprising because if you look at ET, PV, and MF, the MF patients are the ones, unfortunately, that have the more aggressive form of disease. They unfortunately have a survival that's measured on the order of years. And that often, you know, creates a sense of urgency and an acceptance of risk of clinical trial options that may not be appropriate for someone who has a more indolent or slow-growing form of ET, for example. So although I would never say that, you know, ET patients are not important and their problems are not real, when developing therapies and testing therapies, we tend to do that first in the patients where the need is most urgent, where we can characterize the potential benefits, the potential toxicities. And once we have a sense of that, we determine whether that profile of benefit and risk warrants, treating and testing that therapy in patients who may have lower risk diseases, like essential thrombocythemia. So that tends to be the way these things are developed. And I think JAK inhibitors are probably a great example of that. They really entered the field first in patients with myelofibrosis. And once they had a foothold there and we understood the effects of those drugs, the biology behind those drugs and the potential toxicities, for example, ruxolitinib or Jakafi was approved in 2011 for myelofibrosis patients, and then in 2014 for polycythemia vera. It's still not approved for essential thrombocythemia, but there are definitely ET patients in the community who get the drug off-label. Right now, a lot of the focus has been in developing therapies for patients, at least in MF, for patients who have been on ruxolitinib and have either never attained the kind of response from spleen and symptom benefit that that drug can afford, or got that and then lost the response, had toxicities associated with the drug that prohibited continued use of the drug. So second line therapies or salvage treatments are where a lot of focus of drug development is right now in myelofibrosis, either adding novel treatments to ruxolitinib to improve upon the response, or in lieu of ruxolitinib as a new therapy, a second line therapy. That's where a lot of the focus has been. Although I'm excited to say that it's also shifted to some extent. So in myelofibrosis, we're now looking to treat people in a different format. So typically in myelofibrosis, you started a treatment to either address your spleen or your symptom burden, your low blood counts. And then if it worked, you stayed on it till it didn't work. And then you would go on to the next line of therapy. And that was the pattern of treatment and drug development. We're now realizing that that's quite antiquated and probably not the best way to treat patients with myelofibrosis. And if you look at, for example, lymphoma, you don't treat lymphoma patients with one agent. You treat them with a cocktail of agents that exploit different mechanisms of action and have a more profound effect on trying to put patients into a response or a remission. So now in myelofibrosis, if you look what's going on, it's really combinations of therapies and starting therapies earlier on, not waiting for patients to get sicker and sicker with a chronic progressive disease, but starting the combinations earlier, at the onset of treatment, and trying to get deeper responses, more prolonged, durable responses, and hoping that that all translates to improvement in survival of these patients as well.
Yeah, it's so fascinating to hear that that's the shift going on too, because I hear that in other areas like myeloma, it's like hit them harder first, don't be saving something that feels more potent for later.
Yep.
Okay, that's great to know. And just to clarify, you had described myelofibrosis as being survival being counted in number of years. Did you mean number of months or years?
So if you take myelofibrosis, so myelofibrosis is a very heterogeneous disease. And if you took 100 patients with myelofibrosis, the all comers, the median survival is about 5 to 6 years of that group. When you put them into risk groups based on, like, for example, there's the Dynamic International Prognostic Scoring System, which uses 5 independent clinical risk variables to put people into risk groups. So advanced age, a low hemoglobin, circulating blasts, which are immature leukemia cells, a high white count, or systemic symptoms, you can put people into discrete risk groups. If you're in the low risk group, your median survival could be 15 plus years. If you're in the high risk group, your median survival could be less than 2 years. Patients who fail ruxolitinib, for example, the median survival has been reported to be a year, and with certain features could be, 7 months. So, it really depends on, there's so much variability. It really depends on the risk score and where they are in their treatment plan.
We could then, I know there's a lot of different, and there are a lot of different highlights. If we could talk about the fedratinib, just because you talked about fedratinib and the ruxolitinib, there was one study that studied, that looked at patients who didn't respond to any more the ruxolitinib and then continued on the fedratinib. what happened there?
So fedratinib is a JAK2 FLT3 inhibitor. It's a drug that was approved in August of 2019 for patients with myelofibrosis, and the label is broad. It could be used upfront before ruxolitinib, the original approved drug. It could be used second line. And there were two studies called the Jakarta studies that were done that sort of validated that this was an effective drug, either upfront or even in a fraction of patients after they've seen ruxolitinib, which is another JAK inhibitor. So the study at ASH was really looking to see what in the real world setting, so not in a clinical trial where things are often, highly curated and selected. In the real world experience, if you were to look at in this case, we use the Cardinal Health System, which is a large health system in the US, and we looked at their electronic medical record. Can we get patient level data from the electronic medical record, looking at a real world data analysis of what happens when fedratinib is prescribed in the community? Because that's really what matters. I mean, clinical trials are what get drugs approved, but what really matters at the end of the day is when you're not in a clinical trial at a highly specialized center with an expert, but you're in the community being treated, you know, in real life, what happens? Like, do you get the benefit that you should, or that was, you know, presumed to be there based on the clinical trial? What we saw was that patients that were treated with fedratinib in the community, and we looked at 3 months and 6 months analyses of, for example, reduction in spleen, reduction in symptoms, and what we could see from the looking at the electronic medical record using data analysis was that you did see the benefits in symptom and spleen reduction that were similar to what we saw in the actual prospective clinical trial. So that was quite happy to see that the real life experience was not far off from what the clinical trial experience was, and that this was a viable option for patients who had been previously on ruxolitinib.